So thanks for joining me, guys. Like I said, I'm recording this session today because of the recent changes made with the settlement announcement, with the proposed changes that might come about. And we don't know if they will or not, and I'll probably have to record a new one in the future, but we're going to be talking about working with sellers today, and we're going to do it in light of, really for sellers, not a lot of huge changes. But there are a few things that I want you to start changing as a way of doing business, and I want you to start changing today. Don't wait for this proposed settlement. Don't wait for July. Even if, I mean, this proposed settlement, it may drag out for a couple more years. We don't know who's going to weigh in, right? Don't wait for July to make these changes. So let's get started today and talk about working with sellers. Now, we have to approach this, even though many of you are very experienced agents, we have to approach this training for the sake of the training program itself, from the viewpoint of somebody that's never worked with a seller. So bear with me if you're really experienced. But I'm in the unenviable position of having 1 hour to try to teach agents how to work with sellers. I know that's not enough. You know that's not enough. I mean, I could spend this entire time going over one form if I really wanted to dive into it deep. But we're going to do our best here. It's for this reason, by the way, if you're curious, I've got, let me share the screen here. It's for this reason that I created the Elite Agent Training Program. Honestly, I've created this program 20 years ago, but I made it into an online course that you can have access to 24/7, where I can really communicate all of the things that you need to know. I'm not limited to an hour there to try to cover this whole topic. So if you do feel like you need more training, you have access to that. If you need discounts, you can email me directly at brokerericlee@gmail.com. And then you've got my YouTube channel that I've referenced where I cover things in the industry, new forms, new rulings, whatever that come out that are interesting to you guys. All right. So those are some of the resources that you have at your disposal. Every week, I do a challenge for you guys to help you grow your business. And I was going to ask, I told you last week, I would ask you guys if you had done this challenge and I wanted to hear stories. But with this ongoing stuff, we're going to be limited on time even more than we normally are. So I'm just going to hope that you guys have actually done this, that you are not coming here just to listen, but it's to listen and to do. All right. I hope some things are changing and growing in your business. Now, I start out this training working with sellers with this quote that you've all heard. I don't know who to attribute it to. Person doesn't care how much you know until they know how much you care. And I start this because the number one problem that I see with listing agents, the number one challenge for listing agents is that they get overly concerned, especially new agents. They get overly concerned with their presentation. This is a challenge that newer agents face, right? They're really nervous going into their first listing presentation. They're worried about that. The one thing I want you to keep in mind is that we are here to care about people. We're in their home because this is a scary process for them, right? We need to be able to talk to them. We need to hear them. It's hundreds of thousands of dollars on the line. Even if it's not like their first time and they're not scared because they've never done it before, they're scared because, I sold a home a couple of years ago with one of the most successful people I know. He's got his own company, he's got attorneys on staff at his company. And he said, "I've never hired an agent to sell my home before. I understand the forms, I understand the law." And he says, "What I understand now is that things are crazy. And you're the only person that I trust that really understands the contracts." He says, "I don't want to hire some random real estate agent out there. I want to hire somebody that really knows the contracts and can protect me because we're in this crazy world right now." Okay. So don't lean so heavily on your presentation if you're a new agent. Lean on you as a person. You're there to care for somebody. You're there to take care of somebody. And if you can remember that, you're going to do okay as a real estate agent. All right. So things we're going to cover prior to the listing appointment, at the listing appointment, post-listing, some marketing ideas. I may not get into the marketing ideas today. All right. But let's talk about prior to the listing appointment, some of the things that you have available to you as tools. You've got your listing presentation. Now you've got this in several places. You can go to the Equity Marketing Center. There's one. You can go, if you want a really basic one, I've got a basic one that covers all the bases on the Elite Agent Training page. Okay. Those are all fully editable. If you use KV Core, it's got a pretty cool listing presentation that you can use. So we provide you with several different options to get a listing presentation, but you should be doing a presentation with all of your sellers, even if it's your mom and you don't necessarily need to. The reason we do a presentation is to provide uniformity in value. Okay, so if it's my mom wanting to sell her home, I'm going to do a presentation to her because I want referrals from my mom as well. I may not need to do the presentation in order to get her business, but I want her to understand what a professional I am. She's not referring her friends to me because I'm her sweet little son. She needs to be referring her friends to me because I'm a killer listing agent, right? I do a great job as a listing agent. So I need to do my full presentation to everyone. I provide uniformity of value. And then everybody that sees it can refer me out and say, hey, yeah, go with Eric. He did a great job for us. I was really impressed with this and this and this, right? And we need to provide this and this and this to everybody so that they can refer you with confidence. If they heard that you did this and this and this from somebody else and you did it with them, then they can confidently refer you out to someone else because they know that you provide great value and you do it consistently. So again, I mentioned the marketing center. If you haven't gotten in there lately, we're always adding some great tools in there for you. Like for example, most of you, I don't know if you realize it, but there's a really cool backdrop for Zoom. It's a professional equity backdrop. You can go in there and it's under the presentations, right? We've got Dotloop. Some of you are in different states where you're not using Dotloop. Just make sure that you're using the one that your broker recommends. I like Dotloop in Utah because it does provide us with several layers of protection. You know, some Sue happy person calls up the Division of Real Estate and says, hey, my agent didn't give me copies of my forms. And we go to Dotloop and say, yep, here it is. It's date and time stamped. Everything's good. And that's a real scenario. When we show that to the division, they're like, oh, yep, I see that you've done this. We'll close this case immediately. Maybe send them another copy because apparently they've lost theirs. Piece of cake, right? Whereas if I'm hunting through emails and, well, no, I'm sure I remember doing this, then we've got problems. You've got the 24/7 hotline. This is that generic number on the bottom of the equity signs. That goes to the, all of the leads generated from that are routed through your ProAgent website. And so you've got that and it's generating leads for you right now. Some of you, if you've never logged into the back end of your ProAgent website, you don't even realize you're missing out on leads that could be good for you. All right. And then of course we've got KV Core for those of you that are using that. So we noticed that a lot of agents, KV Core is it's a complicated program. A lot of you weren't doing that. So that's why we provided the ProAgent websites. And that's available to everybody. So you've got lots of resources and tools that are provided to you. And it's amazing. It's absolutely astonishing that a company would provide all of that to you at no cost. Okay. That should blow you away. And quite frankly, I want referrals from everybody. Go tell all your friends that Equity Real Estate is the place to be, because quite honestly, with the turmoil out there, even more so coming from this, they're going to want to be with a great brokerage that doesn't take 30% of their commission or charge them extra for these tools. Now, maybe they're not charging extra for the tools, but they're charging 30% of the commission. That's extra, right? So if you want to stay in business, if you've got friends in other brokerages, please refer them to us. All right, prior to listing appointment, these are important things you need to be doing as a new agent. First of all, get detailed information about the house from the client. So you heard a rumor, you know, you saw on Facebook, your friend said they were going to sell you. So you call up your friend and say, hey, you know what? I saw this on Facebook. I'm a listing agent. Have you hired an agent yet? And they say, no, we're not sure if we're going to do it or not. Hey, that's great. I totally understand. Would you like me to tell you everything that I do? I would love to come over and maybe I can just answer some questions for you. Even if you decide to do it yourself as a for sale by owner, you know, I can probably give you some clarification on certain points. But I'd love to show you about my program. And they say, yeah, you know what? Sure, come on over. Okay, so we set the appointment. I'm going to say, okay, tell me a little bit about your house. Well, we've got a 5-bed, 3-bath house. And okay, great. I'm going to be taking notes about all of these things. Now, interestingly enough, when I actually dig into the details, or maybe I go and walk through the home, it's not a 5-bed, 3-bath, you know, because they didn't specify it was a 5-bed, 1 full bath, 1 3-quarter bath, and 1 half bath, right? This is a 5-bed, 3-bath. And to be fair, I'm not sure as an adult I knew the difference between a full bath and a half bath and a 3-quarter bath until I got into real estate. Those were terms that were just never used, right? So they don't know all of these things, but you want to hear what they think from their perspective. It's very common to see people calling a five, you know, it's a 5-bed, 3-bath house, but that last bedroom is in the basement and it's an old house. It's got a 6-foot-tall ceiling. It works for their kid, but there's no window in it and there's no closet, you know, but they stuck a kid down there because they had a kid to stick somewhere, right? So they call it a bedroom. And legally, it's not a bedroom. But you know at least what their impression of their house is, right? So you've got all those notes. But that's not enough. Now we're going to go to the MLS and we're going to check the MLS for previous listings. And so we know the address, right? So we're going to put the address in there. But folks, I just sold a home last week that had 2 different addresses, right? So one of the things that I do is I'll put in the house number. Usually that doesn't change. Sometimes it does, though, if it's on a corner or something weird. But I'll usually put in the house number in the county because I've had agents call me quite often saying, hey, I know this home has been listed before. They've told me it's been listed before, but they let some people in. But I can't find it anywhere on the MLS. I know it's been there before. It's because they got too narrow in their search. Right? They put in the address, the city, the county. Cities change, lines change over time. Usually the house number of the county doesn't, and you'll pull up 30 or 40 with that same house number in that county, and it's really easy to find the ones. I don't narrow it down to active sold or anything like that. I don't remove any of that criteria. I'm just looking for any time it was previously listed. Because if it's active, quite frankly, I want to know that before I go on an appointment, right? I shouldn't be going on an appointment on an active listing. So anyways, I want to check the MLS. Now that's going to give me some information, but folks, I don't have time to share with you today. I've owned homes where I checked the previous MLS listing and 5 different listings, 5 different square footage measurements. Okay. 5 different listing, 3 different yard size measurements. Now, unless you're living in Hawaii and you've got lava fields expanding your backyard every day, our yard sizes shouldn't be changing, right? So you can't rely on the MLS for accuracy either. I've seen agents list homes on the MLS that were off by a full 1,000 square feet on their square footage. That's a lot. You know, if you're selling a home for and average square footage is going for $200 a square foot and you're off by 1,000 square feet in your measurement, that's $200,000 potentially that you're off by. Okay, so we're not going to take that as the gospel truth either. So we're going to check title. Now, with our MLS here, I can click the tax ID number and it pulls up some information for me. But I heard one this last week. I'm covering for another broker and I heard a scenario that I'd never heard before. They did click that and they followed the information on that tax ID link, but they got to closing and title said, oh, where's so-and-so? He should be here to sign as well. And they're like, what are you talking about? There is nobody else is on title. It was the day of closing. They had pulled title. They had checked all of that stuff, but nobody noticed that it was, I think, a trust scenario or no, somebody had passed away. Anyways, they'd missed a guy on title. So you want to check title right up front and not just clicking that link on the MLS. Actually call the title company right up front. And, you know, this is all prior to the listing appointment. They're not going to have time to do their full search, but they can do a quick preliminary search and get you some good information. Now, is this going to be the gospel truth? No, it's not. All right. you're going to find, by the way, I want to make sure you guys, okay, I see some movement. I want to make sure that I'm not frozen. Sometimes you look frozen, but it's me that's frozen. So I like people sharing their screens so that I can move on and know that it's not an internet connection thing. And I'm just talking to the air. All right, so we check title, but title quite often, it'll only show above grade square footage, right? And it doesn't show below grade. So again, but you should have a few things that are accurate there. You should know the year built. You should know the people that are on title. And between those three things, the information that you got from the client, the previous MLS listings, and title, we should have enough that we can now go ahead and prepare a CMA, a comparative marketing analysis. And by the way, I do want you to be careful when you're talking to clients. Remember that they don't speak our lingo. And we, hey, yeah, I checked the MLS and I built a CMA. And they're like, what the hell are you talking about? Right? Okay. We need to remember to relate to them on their level. So we have enough now to prepare a CMA. Let's talk about what goes into a CMA. There needs to be a marketing plan. All right. Here's what I plan on doing to help you sell your home. Now, all three of those things that I reference, whether you're getting it off KV Core, you're going to the marketing center in Elevate, or you're getting the one that's, you know, the little Microsoft Word edition that you can edit from the bottom of my Elite Agent training site, they all have a marketing plan in there. All right. So you want to go in there and customize that. What is it that you do? You need to have an explanation of what a market analysis is, what a CMA is, okay? Why they can't count the, you know, they're in a 40-year-old neighborhood, but there was a vacant lot across their street and somebody just bought it and built a brand new home. That's not a comp for them. Hey, they just bought this brand new home across the street for $1.1 million. Great, that's not a comp that we use. They need to understand that, right? We need to have a spot in there where we discuss the subject property and the comparable properties. So this is what you told me about your home. This is what I learned about it from the other resources, the title, the MLS, this kind of thing. We have that discussion and we discuss why these are the comparable properties that we can use. We need to discuss, there's three different graphs. And I like putting some graphs in because some people are visual learners. Some people you can talk to, some people are visual. So we've got a market activity, a pricing pyramid, consequences of overpricing. These are all little graphs or charts that we put in there that explains to people the dangers of overpricing a home, right? It can sit on the market for a long time. People see the days on market. Its value actually decreases because of the days on market, because as a buyer, we come in and we say, oh, this home's been on the market for 6 months when the average time on market is 2 months. Something must be wrong with this home. Everybody else has seen it. I don't want to get involved with a problematic home, right? We need to have that discussion with them. And so we have a couple of different ways to bring that up. We have a price recommendation from the work that we've done. And I want to talk with you a little bit about that price recommendation here at this point. Okay, we are not appraisers. We're not licensed as appraisers. Most of us aren't anyway. Some people do have a dual license. Sorry, I missed a chat that was typed in here. Just somebody had typed in, title doesn't show when the owner completes the basement and adds rooms like additional beds and baths. So again, we're not going to be fully reliant on what the title report says either. Sorry, I had missed that chat when it was relevant. Okay, back to the comparative market analysis. And we were talking about price recommendation. We're not appraisers. We're not licensed as appraisers. So most of us go into it and there's a lot of pressure on a new agent, even sometimes experienced agents that will call me up and say, can you help me with a CMA on this? This is a very unique property. And one of my first things that I want all of you to understand is that we are even appraisers. Like you could hire three appraisers to do an appraisal on a home. They're all going to come up with a different number. All right. Take the pressure off of yourself to be perfect. There is no perfect in this. We are making educated guesswork with the tools that we have, which are way better than the tools that your client has. Okay. Your client has an appraisal they did 5 years ago when they refinanced. That's how they're pricing their home. I know this because I've talked to a lot of for sale by owners and that's how they price their home. So inaccurate, right? They're pricing it from stuff they saw online, from the flyer they stole from the neighbor's house across the street. Okay, that's their tools. We have much, much better tools, but it's still not a science where we get an exact number every time we do it. So take that pressure off yourself. I also recommend when doing a CMA, I recommend that we don't narrow it to three homes because you probably haven't seen the home yet. This is all prior to the listing appointment, remember? So you don't need to narrow it down to three homes. A rookie mistake, and by the way, I do have this discussion in my listing presentation. Rookies make the mistake of pulling up the comps and picking the three highest comps because they want to go out there and they want to sit down with the people and they want to say, hey, this is what I can sell your house for. Here's the comps, not knowing any better, right? But folks, almost every single listing that I do, I'll pull comps and there's at least a $100,000 spread between the high end of comps and the low end of comps. Now, these are all comps by qualifiers, plus or minus 5 years of age. You know, it's within a mile or so. It all sold within the last 6 months. It's the same style of home. But one was extremely well cared for. It was a model home. The people have done professional landscaping. They've put in all the high-end stuff. And the other one was a meth home where they changed the oil of their Harley in the living room and they had anger management problems and punched holes in all the walls. And when they finally got evicted, they took the tub with them, right? You're going to have a different spread. But by age and by all the metrics of a comp, they're both comps. Okay. So you're going to see this huge spread from one end to the other. Which one do you use when you haven't seen the home? And I have this conversation in my listing presentation. And I say, here's why I'm giving you this information. Because a brand new agent that doesn't know any better is going to pick the three highest comps. They're going to come to you and they're going to say, we can sell your home for this. But you might not have the granite countertops, you might not have all the high-end stuff, all the high-end features that these other homes have. And if you list your home in competition with these other homes, you will never sell because put yourself in a buyer's shoes. If you saw your house for that price and you saw another house that had all these extra fixings for that price, which one would you choose? You'd choose the other one. So I don't approach it with that model. But a brand new agent that doesn't know any better, he's just trying to get your business. That's what he does. Okay? So it's not his fault. He's not nefarious. He just doesn't know any better. Now, we do have agents that do know better. And they'll come and sit down with you and they'll say, I sell 150 homes a year. The average agent sells three homes a year. You can't trust anybody but me. I'm the best. I'm the best. Everybody loves me. Everybody knows it. I'm the very best, right? And this is what you're going to sell your home for. And you say, oh, but I met with this other. That other agent doesn't know anything. I pulled the numbers on him. He only closed one home last year. I'm the best. Right? And they're very convincing and they're very good because they sell 150 homes a year. Right? I guarantee you, I'll sell your home in a month or 2 months or less. Guaranteed to sell your home in a month or less. How do they guarantee that? Typically, they're going towards the lower end of the comp spectrum. How do you guarantee you sell a home for, you know, in a market where the average days on market is 3 months? How do you guarantee for a month? It's not because you're extra marketing, it's because you underprice it a little bit. Because that's how you sell 150 homes a year. You put it on the market, boom, it's sold. Put it on the market, boom, it's sold. It's not necessarily looking after your best interest, Mr. and Mrs. Seller. And they're going to think in their head, I just interviewed that guy yesterday. I was going to go with him. Now I'm not. Okay? Because that's exactly the kind of stuff that they did. And then I say, and here's what I do. I said, I come and I've got three comps from the very highest end. I've got three comps from the low end and I've got three comps from the middle. Because I didn't know what your home was going to look like before I stepped into it today. And by the way, there's a lot of people that have complained to me that the listing agent came into their home, sat down to their table and said, this is what your home's worth, and never even walked the home. I hear that all the time. Okay, that's insane. That's ridiculous, right? Because we've got comps that cover over 100,000 spread. I did one the other day for an agent. I helped him out. It was almost $300,000 spread from high end to low end of legitimate comps. How do you walk into a home and sit down without looking at the home and say, here's the comps that apply to you? You can't. So I go with 3 pages of comps because I can fit 3 on each page. So, and I figure that's not too much. It's not overkill because back when I was in a different business and we looked over resumes, I could handle a 3-page resume. Most resumes were 2 pages. 3 pages was towards the top end, but that's digestible information, right? So I show up with 3 pages of comps, 3 from the high end, 3 from the middle, 3 from the low end. In so doing, I've called the bluff of every other agent that they've interviewed. That agent that sells 150, they don't really want to work with him anymore, because he's directing them towards the low end so that they can sell their home really quickly. Most people would rather keep their home on the market 3 months and make an extra $40,000. $40,000 in 3 months? Heck yeah, sign us up, right? Okay, they're not in such a hurry to sell it that they're willing to lose 40 grand. Most people don't want to hire that brand new agent who told them, and by the way, if he's the only person they interviewed, they would hire him. But he's not going to make any commission, because he told them their, you know, their home's worth actually 850. He told them list it for 900. And they list it for 900, and it is not comparable to those other model homes. It doesn't have the trim and the fixings and the granite and all that stuff. Okay, it doesn't have that. So it doesn't sell. So he comes back with hat in hand, a little sheepish because he's a new agent, and asks for a price reduction. And you will have to ask for price reductions in your career. You just don't do it sheepishly or with hat in hand. You do it boldly. Okay? But the new agent doesn't. He comes to him and says, hey, I don't know what's going on. It's not selling. We need to do a price reduction. And it's already a month or 2 months in. If you're going to do a price reduction, you need to be doing it in 2 weeks. You need to do it boldly. But this agent doesn't know that. He's coming in 2 months later. And you do a price reduction. It's not even sufficient to reach new people. And so he lists and he works for 6 months and he works hard. He's so desperate to get that commission, you know, a $900,000 commission, and say he's making the math on that at 3% would be $27,000. That's life-changing for him, but he doesn't get it. He doesn't get the closing. He doesn't get the money, and he doesn't get any referrals either. That's why I say it's a rookie mistake. You might've won the listing, but all you won was 6 months of free work, with nothing at the end of it. No referrals, no commission, nothing. So I go in with my different price recommendations, and I walk through the home, and then I'll say to them boldly, you know what? Here's the 3 high end, here's the 3 low end, here's the 3 middle. I think due to the condition of your home, we're more like the middle. Or holy cow, your home is amazing. We're looking at these high end ones. Or I see you've had a troubled teenager and all these holes in the walls, and you're clearly doing meth. So we're going to be way down here doing the investor special, right? And I'm going to be direct with them. I've gone into homes that were hoarder homes, literally tunnels carved through the home with waste 4 or 5 feet high all around. One chair cleaned off, everything else covered. Filled with rats. That person, I was very direct. And I said, you'll make $40,000 more if you can clean this out. And she said, I can't do it. They said, okay, it's an investor special. And I'm actually going to get it in writing that I told you we could get $40,000 more for it by cleaning it out. She says, I understand. I can't do it. Signed the listing agreement, sold it to an investor for less. All right. It's okay to be blunt with people. They want somebody to tell them the truth. So I show up with 3 sets of comps with different price recommendations because I haven't seen the home yet. It could fall anywhere in that realm. And then I like to have several different listing options as well. And I'll get to that in a second, but we're going to have to move quickly here. I'm going to put all this together in a listing presentation. If you're a brand new agent, you don't need to do a whole lot of information about you. I don't care if I'm the seller that you have, that you're married and have 3 kids and a dog and like to take long walks on the beach. I don't care. Okay. And I'm sorry, but this is the way people are. No offense to your dog and the beach. Okay. When you come into my home, I've got 2 big concerns. Number 1, how much can I get out of my house? Number 2, what are you going to do to help me get that? If you answer that, over time, we may be friends and I do care about your dog and the beach, but for now I don't. So don't spend a lot of time on this. We've got very limited time. And here's where, because in this listing presentation, introduce ourselves. We're going to do that full CMA that we just talked about. We're going to explain the comps and the recommended price. You know, those three different pages there, what I just went over, that dialogue with you. We're going to go over some pricing options. We're going to resolve concerns. And we have to do all of this in 1 hour. There's your one cardinal rule. Okay, I'll tell you my first listing presentation story. It was to a neighbor. This was a neighbor that we got along with. We knew well. We had done barbecues together. We were close as a family. And I did a 2.5 hour listing presentation because I was so nervous. I just couldn't stop talking. And you know what? At the end of the day, they didn't sign with me because their kids were tired and they needed to put them to bed. When you go over to a listing presentation, y'all have been in a meeting where the person is like, you know, sharing this amazing story, but noon ticks over. The meeting was scheduled to end at noon, and it doesn't matter how amazing the story is. A third of the audience gets up and walks out because it's lunchtime, or they had another appointment, right? We need to be cognizant of that when we're doing our listing presentation, that we have to accomplish our goal within an hour. That goal is meet and greet the family right here, walk through the home with a clipboard, or your notepad, or your iPad, or whatever it is, but we're going to be taking notes. So we're killing three birds with this one stone. Taking notes for our remarks section later. When we put it on the MLS, we've got to have cute, charming bungalow, three bed, two, whatever, right? Introduce fixture concept and take notes on inclusions and exclusions. Before you ever sit down with them and give your presentation, they need to see you as a professional. And they do that by thinking, oh, wow, we never even thought about whether we were going to include the fridge. Guys, folks have never thought about something so basic as whether or not to include the fridge. That's basic, 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 and they never thought about it. And that dawns on them before they ever sit down over a kitchen table with you. So here's how you approach this. Okay, you knock on their door, they meet you, you walk in, you say, oh, great, your house is lovely. You know, you meet everybody, you shake hands, and they say, so where do we need to do this? Do we need to do this at the kitchen table? Do we need to do this in the living room? And I peek in at the kitchen table because it's much easier to sign forms on a kitchen table and show forms. But if they just finished dinner and the table isn't cleared, then I say, you know what, we can do it right here in the living room. Because I've come prepared with a three-ring binder and all the forms are punched and ready to go in here, and I can hand this over to them in their lap and they can sign forms, right? I've come prepared with that. So I don't want them to scramble and clean the table off and use 10 minutes of my 1 hour allotted time for that. Why do I have 1 hour allotted time? I don't know. It's just what people set aside. When they say somebody's coming over, they just mentally allocate an hour to you. If you take more than that, you're screwed. Okay? You're not going to get the deal. So they say, where do we need to meet? I peek in, kitchen table's clear. Let's meet at the kitchen table. But before we do that, would you mind taking me on a tour of your house? Right away, I take the lead. They're hiring a leader, right? They're hiring a leader. Remember that. Even if you're a brand new agent, they're hiring a leader. So yeah, we can do it at the kitchen table or we can do it in the living room. But before we do that, why don't you take me on a tour? And as we go around the tour, I'm taking notes. I'm asking questions. What's your favorite feature about the house? Tell me why it is that you're moving. Seems like a lovely place, right? All of these are things that I can ask in person that asking over the phone, especially if I don't have a personal relationship with them yet, it may raise flags for them. Okay. So as we go through, I introduce the concept of fixtures and I'll ask inane things like, oh, I see the blinds here. That's actually one of the things on our inclusions and exclusions list. So I'm going to ask, you plan on keeping the blinds? And they're, well, yeah, don't, or no, we're going to leave those. Don't most people leave them? I say, yeah, most people do. It's actually one of the questions that we need to do. And I ask that because anything that's physically attached to the home is deemed as automatically included. So if you have things like, you know, shelving that you made that you're very handy, or a chandelier that was passed down for generations, and we need to exclude that. I've even heard a story of somebody who had their favorite toilet that they had imported from Canada because there were no limitations on the flush volume, right? Like all of our toilets sold now, you know, they're trying to be water conserving. And this guy had imported a toilet that had no concerns about water conservation at all. And he loved that toilet and he was going to take it with him. I need to know about that now because we need to specifically exclude that from the sale. Otherwise, it's automatically included. And we have that conversation as we're walking around, and they're thinking, oh, wow, I'm sure glad I'm talking to a professional here because I never would have considered these things, right? And then last but not least, as I mentioned earlier, we have to do this before we sit down and talk price, because it's very offensive to people for you to walk in their home and say, your home is worth this much, and you've never even seen their home. So by the time we sit down, they see us as a professional. We've already beat half the competition that didn't even bother to walk home, right? If we're their fourth interview and two of them didn't even bother to walk home, which is happening, we've already beat two of them out. Okay, now it's only us competing with one other person. And then we sit down and we do our presentation and we show them the numbers and we have that discussion on, here's why I present three from the high end, three from the low end, three from the middle. This is where I think we need to be. How much did you hope to get out of your home? Okay, here's where the competition is at. Once we do that, we've beat the other person as well. All right, so we go over our listing presentation. We've only got 40 minutes to do all of that, because our goal is to walk out the door with a signed agreement. Now, what if we get to the end and they say, but we're not ready to list it yet. There's a few things we need to do still. We plan on, you know, we're going to clean this up. Obviously, we've got to take a couple of loads. You know, we've been storing a bunch of our kids' stuff, so we need to have them come and pick that up. So we won't be ready to list it for another 3 weeks. Do we sign the paperwork today or do we wait 3 weeks? We sign it today. We sign it today. Otherwise, you get in this follow-up nightmare where you're calling them and they're not returning the call. And it's because they lost their phone. They dropped it in the toilet. But that's not what you think. You think, oh, they hate me. They've chosen somebody else. I've called them four times. They haven't responded to anything. They dropped their phone in the toilet. Right? So we want to avoid all of that stuff. They went on vacation. There's so many different reasons they didn't call you. We want to avoid all of that. We want to sign this tonight. So we sign it tonight and we bring an addendum. So you take out your exclusive right to sell paperwork and an addendum with you that says we won't put this home on the market until further written notice from the seller, because there's some things that they want to do around the house first before it goes active, right? So no marketing will take place until this time. And we put that in the addendum. Then we can get the agreement signed tonight. You know, hey, I'm here. Let's get the paperwork out of the way while I'm here, right? Now, we're going to ask which plan fits their needs the best, and I'll show you a couple of plan options. Number one, I used to charge 7% because I would provide moving services. I say, you know, one of the biggest hassles of moving is, or of selling your home is the actual moving. And I've contracted with a local moving company to provide moving services for you. And I knew that with an extra 1% commission, it would cover the cost of that moving company, right? So I could do this. This is my deluxe service. Or I've got my standard service fee, which is 6%, where you don't want the extra moving. Or I can even offer you a 5% option where you're moving locally and you have me help you on the buyer side. And I'll go out there to my listing with a listing agreement and an addendum to listing agreement and my buyer agency agreement. I might walk out the door with a listing and a buyer signed on. Okay. So if you're moving locally and I can help you with that, I'll give you a discount on the listing side as well. I'll do my side for 2%. We'll offer 3% to a buyer's agent or however you guys want to do that. Or I can do a combination. Okay. Maybe they're moving locally, but they do want the moving services. Well, I'll give you all that for 6%. So another agent might charge 6% and not provide moving services, but because they're going to sign with me as a buyer's agent as well, I'm going to give them 6% and moving services. Okay, this is up to you. You can be creative in how you negotiate things out. Here's the one thing that I want to cover that is different. Take the time to explain the value of having a buyer's agent and why that offer of compensation can be in their best interest. For me, I'm going to share a screen with you. Let's see, it's this one. Okay, this is the MLS. This is the exclusive right to sell listing agreement and agency disclosure form that we're looking at for Utah right now. We're going to jump down to section 2 here. And I wish I had more time to cover this, but we're coming up on our time limit. I may go a titch over because of our earlier discussion. All right, but right here, We've got that the seller has negotiated and agrees to pay to the company a brokerage fee in the amount of, could be dollars and this. So I could charge, you know, I'm going to charge a $199 fee plus a 5% commission, whatever. Okay. It's up to you how you do it. Let's say that they chose to do my moving services. We're going to charge 7% here. Well, I want you to know right up front, Mr. Seller, Mr. and Mrs. Seller, that additionally, we're going to offer to share a portion of this brokerage fee. Now this says is advertised on the MLS. That's probably going to go away. We're not going to be able to advertise it on the MLS, but we are able to tell other brokerages, hey, I'm going to offer 3% of this 7, because mind you, I've got to take some of that and pay for the moving services, right? And this amount offered on the MLS may be modified only with the consent of the seller. So once I offer this, I'm going to pay this unless, you know, me and the seller change it. And then we've got in bold here, brokerage fees are not set by any board or association of realtors or MLS or in any manner other than between the company and seller. And this is how it's always been. We're just being very clear with that. Now, Mr. and Mrs. Seller, I want to tell you why this is important. You understand this, okay? Why is it important to have a buyer's agent involved? And why would you want to offer that compensation? You know, why doesn't that buyer pay for their own agent? Okay. Well, first of all, let's answer that last question. Why doesn't a buyer want to pay for their own agent? Because they've already got to come up with a down payment and closing costs, neither of which you have to worry about. So if we add on there the brokerage fees, it's going to knock out of your realm of buyers a big chunk. We're going to be removing a significant portion of buyers from the market for your home because they just simply don't have that available for them. All right. So why is it in your best interest to have a buyer's agent involved? Well, because when, you know, put yourself in the buyer's shoes for a minute, they're going to be coming and seeing a home and maybe they did find the home themselves online. Maybe they don't have an agent, right? Well, how are they going to get the right offer paperwork put together? They're going to Google it and find forms. I've seen them do that with the wrong state forms, something from a different state, which is entirely irrelevant here in Utah. Okay. I've seen them make forms, very intelligent people, write offers on a blank 8.5 by 11, handwriting offers. And when both people were getting sued, buyers and sellers were suing each other. That's when they called me up and I said, whoa, I don't get involved at this point. This is attorney land, right? So as a seller, you want somebody that knows where the right forms are, how to fill those forms are out correctly, right? That's in your best interest because you don't want to be getting sued later on. So who's going to help them with the forms? Well, if they come along and they're unrepresented, I'm going to have to help them. In which case, I'm going to make this full 7% because I'm going to have increased liability. I'm going to have to help them out. Now, maybe in Utah, it's allowable for me to have to be a limited agent with them. I can represent both sides. If that happens, I want you to know how that works. And I would explain the concept of limited agency. Like, for example, that buyer comes to me and they say, what price do you think we should offer? By law, I have to say asking price, unless you've given me written instructions to say otherwise. So that buyer's not getting great representation. There's nobody really negotiating on their behalf there, right? So I tell the buyer, you have to offer asking price, you know, or I recommend. I can't say you have to. I say, I recommend you offer asking price. Now that buyer's going to be thinking, I don't know if somebody's really looking out for my best interest here. And that's with limited agency, which is their best case scenario. If nobody's representing them, it's going to be even worse. We're not going to have the right paperwork. They're not, you know, they're going to do their inspection and they're going to get a 16-page inspection report. If you guys have ever bought a home, you know, as if we're doing a role play here, if you sellers have ever bought a home, you've seen those inspection reports. They're going to get that inspection report and your deal's going to be dead. There's no buyer's agent saying, hey, okay, let's not worry about these things. This is doable. This is a trip to Lowe's. You know, yes, we don't have the fixture covers here. That's literally less than a dollar at Lowe's to buy that fixture cover. We're not going to kill the sell of a home because it doesn't have fixture covers, right? for that light fixture. We're not killing the sale of a home for that. But I've seen buyers walk away for stuff. Simple as that, right? Buyer's agents help them get across those hurdles. Now you're hiring me as your agent. Why don't I just help them across those hurdles? Because they know I'm your agent. There's just an inherent distrust there, and probably rightfully so. I don't have a fiduciary duty to them unless I'm representing them. So this is why, as a seller, we're offering 3% to a buyer's agent, because that's what help gets the deal across the finish line. And I want you to know up front, if somebody comes without an agent, with no representation, I'm going to be put in the position of helping them across that finish line. It more than doubles my risk. It more than doubles my liability. I can help them, but it puts me at significant risk, so I do not give a discount. This whole 7% would then come to me. Are we clear? Okay, great. Let's sign the paperwork. We roll down here and we're going to, you know, initial here, and we're done. Now, let me, I know I've gone over, but bear with me just a little bit longer. Okay. So they're going to say, wait, we haven't even talked price yet. We haven't even established a price. I said, I know, but we close before we talk price. I want you to hire me, not because of the price I tell you. I've shown you a spectrum of comps with a $200,000 spread from high end to low end. You don't choose the agent. We've already discussed this. You know it. I know it. You don't choose the agent based on what they say you can sell your house for. We can list your house anywhere on the spectrum. Okay. But I'm going to be blunt with you. If you list it up here, I'm going to ask you for a price reduction in 2 weeks, maybe 1 week if it's way out here. Okay. I'm going to ask you for a price reduction because we need to get that price in line and we need to do it quickly. Otherwise, we're facing this viewpoint of buyers saying, whoa, what's wrong with that house? It's been on the market forever. So I'll list it wherever you want me to, but let's have a discussion on price now. Okay. You're choosing to hire me because I'm the agent that you want and I'm the agent that you need and I'm the agent that can do the job. Okay. You're not choosing to hire me because of the price I tell you. That's for us to decide together. If you have to move like ASAP because your job started yesterday in another state, we're going to need to price it lower. Right? If you don't care if you even sell the home, unless you get this price, we're just fishing a little bit. Hey, if somebody's willing to offer this price, then yeah, I'll sell. That'll make sense to me at that point. Okay. But I'm going to tell you the truth. We may both be pleasantly surprised. I don't think it'll sell for that. But I'm going to tell you the truth. So we close before we talk price. All right. Now is when I pull out, you know, now is when we dig into the comps. And if they say, oh, can you just leave these comps with me? Nope. Not unless we've closed, not unless we've signed an agreement. If we sign an agreement, then yeah, absolutely. I'll leave all of this information with you. But if they say, you know, we don't want to sign anything today. We want to think about it. Okay, great. Think about it. I pack up all my stuff. Right? And by the way, my listing presentation doesn't include the comps. Those are separate. Those three pages of numbers, those are separate. That's for my price discussion. I don't leave those with people unless they've signed with me. Because I hate seeing agents do all of this work that we've just discussed. All of this prep work. Okay, you've already spent hours on it before you even sat down with them. And then they take your comps and go out and either list it with a discount broker, somebody charging way less just to put it on the MLS because that person never saw the home. You know, the guys that are charging a flat fee of $600 or $700 to post it, they don't drive out to see the home, right? You've done all this work. They didn't pull comps. You've done all this work. Don't let that work go to somebody else. Okay. So I don't have the price discussion until they've chosen to hire me. Once they've chosen to hire me and we've signed that paperwork, we can take a little bit more time. Okay. If they're not in a rush, we can walk around the house and we can say, okay, I'll give you some tips on preparing a home, on staging the home. If you need to run right now, your favorite TV show starting, you're hungry for dinner, the kids are whining, you need to go to bed, whatever it is, we can come back at a later time and we can take care of those things. But tonight we got the listing agreement signed. You know, you've got somebody in your corner. and we've got the leisure to do these other things later. Does that make sense, folks? Yes?
Yes, thank you, Rick.
So what I would like to see from you guys is do a better job than we've ever done before on that section 2 of the exclusive right to sell listing agreement, or if you know whatever form you use in your state, do a better job than ever before of explaining why we include a buyer's agent and why that is important for them. Getting the deal across the finish line without a buyer's agent is going to be very hard for you. It's going to be increased risk for you. Your sellers need to understand that. This isn't just a question of buyer's agents communicating their value better. Listing agents need to communicate why, as a seller, we want to offer a commission to a buyer's agent. We're not hiring people to negotiate against us. Okay? We're trying to get the home sold. And it doesn't get sold when people are scared or timid or don't know the forms or don't know how to take the next step forward, don't know how to negotiate appraisals, don't know how to negotiate inspections. That doesn't sell a home. And we can do a better job explaining that. All right?
Thanks, Eric.
Thank you.
There we are.
That was awesome.
I need more thumbs. I need more thumbs. Ron, thumbs. There we go. I can go to bed now knowing that I've done a good job because I got 2 thumbs up from Ron. Thanks, you guys. Appreciate joining.